We'll make another part of this permanent world in the coal towns. You have this group of mush people, like Sandy, who's got some education off-island, who lives on the Myra, has a nice house on the Myra, and it's kind of stuck in between. It's kind of a tenuous place to be. All right, here we go. So let's talk about etiquette. Last year I saw a great talk by Dr. Andrew Parnaby on YouTube. And he had that picture on the left from the organization of the March of Concern in 67. What do you notice about that photograph on the left? Nobody's sitting in the front chairs. And then the other thing is, what don't you see? And what you don't see is the podium. And who's sitting on the podium? Priests. Father Andy Hogan, right? Labor types. So there you see hierarchies, right? Distance is a sign of deference for lessers. So if you're just a coal miner and you're with JB or somebody from the Antigonish movement, you leave that row of seats for them. That's social stratification, right there, Cape Breton style. You also notice that these guys have very bad body language. Look at them like this. I used to be a Eucharistic minister, and the guys always sit like this. I think that has to do with the fact that they're looking up at a higher power. In the sense of the clergy, I don't mean that they're looking necessarily at God, but that there's a sense that there's a divide between them and the altar. I'm guessing, because I used to stand up there, and the guys didn't look too happy about it. But there was a sense of deference. Discretion, on the other hand, is a sign of respect from betters. That is Irving Schwartz. I think that picture was taken in 1950. Irving Schwartz, as you know, was wealthy. He was more than a prominent citizen, right? And yet he lived in a little rancher near St. Rita's. He owned a little black Toyota. And then after that, he owned a little black Camry. So the idea is that if you are wealthy or powerful in Cape Breton, if you are from a higher social stratosphere, you keep it on the down low. You're discreet. There's a fellow I know who's basically a composite of two or three people. I call him Ian. He's a doctor. He always eats at Mike's lunch. And he invests in, in New Dawn, and he writes poetry, and he's a really nice guy. And he goes to church, and he doesn't take the front row. In fact, he goes to church an awful lot more than J.B. Tompkins ever went to church. But it's interesting, because I would hang with Ian, and all his patients would come up and say hello and give him best wishes, but they wouldn't get too close, and they wouldn't stay too long. Right? The other thing is that Ian would always tell me to be discreet. Ian, he wasn't fond of Lyndon McIntyre's novels about the bishop's man, because he said they were indiscreet. They were romana glen. And Ian goes for long walks by himself. Now again, I'm giving you sort of worst case scenarios about these things and sort of extremes and archetypes. But these are the kind of dynamics at play. Am I in the ballpark on these things? All right. So, who are we? Who is the common man? Who is a true Cape Bretoner? Now this is something I want to say. I'm starting to relax now, so I'm going to say this. And I haven't even had a drink, so that's good. Let me say this. There is no Cape Bretoner. And what do I mean by that? Is that there are many Cape Bretons, and there are many Cape Bretoners. There is Aboriginal Cape Breton. There is French and Acadian Cape Breton. There is Loyalist Cape Breton, there is Gaelic Cape Breton, there is Industrial Cape Breton that includes East Europeans and Mediterraneans, and now there's a Cape Breton that includes Saudis and Asian students in Glace Bay. Which is the real Cape Breton? Who is the true Cape Breton? Who is we? Who are we as Cape Bretoners? I don't have any answers for that, but I will pose the question. I interviewed John Morgan. And John Morgan was a man of the people. I like John Morgan, and I interviewed him, and it took a long time to get that interview. And he's an honorable man. But he was a champion of the common man, right? The people. He would get 80% of the vote of the people. The people's vote. And I was talking to his foster brother, Paul Coombs. He said, he couldn't be bought. He couldn't be bought. And the interesting thing about John Morgan, as noble as he is, now he's starving. He fought, and now he's not eating. So who are we? Well, true Cape Bretoners are not the establishment, according to John Morgan. Nor are they the courtiers. When I interviewed John, and I like John, but he would talk about the courtiers, and he'd let the word roll around in his mouth. Courtier, courtier, the courtier. It's that sense of us and them, right? Us versus them. He could never get a job at the law courts. Right? He was going to fight for Cape Breton. He's a complicated fellow, John Morgan. But he's, as far as a historical figure, it's fascinating. He towers over the first part of the 21st century. But again, I just want to raise this question of who are Cape Bretoners? What does it mean to be a Cape Bretoner? Who are true Cape Bretoners? And then there's a sense, too, that comes with being a beleaguered people. What's that on the sign? We deserve better. Do we? Do we really? Maybe. We deserve better. We'll move on. We'll talk about permanent loans. You know that? I didn't steal it. It was just a permanent loan. Right? So, if we go back to Dave Dingwall, right? Dave Dingwall said, he who has the gold rules. So that power is arbitrary. He knew it. He passed around trinkets at the Bayplex and the Dingwall and all the rest of it. He knew it. And in the end, he was run out of office because he couldn't provide what a chieftain provides, right? He couldn't do it. So if the game is rigged, if rules are arbitrary, and if it's fight or eat, or fight or starve, then you do what you have to do. And so taking the law into your hand in small ways becomes normalized. So let's talk about some of these things. Back in the 70s, remember in the fall, all the guys at DEFCO would get the flu in hunting season, right? My dad was a purchasing agent, so he'd always order 1,800 raincoats, even though there were only 900 guys. And the Waterford, apparently guys from the Lingam would steal a vice grip so often that their wives would use them as clothespins. And the thing is, I'm no saint, right? I'm no saint either, because I played the pokey game, and I used drag. How do you think I got a job at the heavy water plant in 1983? My dad worked there, right? And my mom was always ticked off when Dave Dingwall wouldn't get her a grant, because she worked for Dave Dingwall. She didn't have drag, right? But these are scarcity-driven economies, so respect for the rules tends to go out the window when you're starving. My mother, God bless her, she's gone, so I can say this, she used to buy illegal smokes all the time from down around Tim's, right? And if you go to I love the flea market. I could write a book about the flea market, because you know some of that stuff is hot, right? A lot of that stuff is neatly saran wrapped. You know, there's Lululemon gear and Beats headphones. And you're thinking, that's okay. People go buy it. These things are normal, right? A very sad case is that sometimes you'll hear of seniors who are very poor, and they'll sell some pills, right, to eat. Now that's not so funny. That's the downside. I mean, a lot of this, I'm being flippant, but that's the downside of this. And then, of course, there's arson as a financial strategy. You know, my uncle, I mean, this is my dissertation. My uncle got me one of his houses, you know, he got behind, so he burned it down, and he built another one. You could buy a house for $20,000, right, the insurance is for $100,000, you split the difference, you make a nice profit, right? Again, what happens is these things become normalized. And this is my favorite picture of them all. triple parked at the liquor commission. Everybody triple parks at the liquor commission. And the thing is, you can get a nice parking spot maybe 10 feet back, but it's true, right? And so these aren't terrible crimes. These aren't Tom Barrett murders, right? These aren't Tom Barrett murders. These are just little things. But like drops of water in the bucket, they add up. Now I want to talk about some chilling things. And we're getting to the end here. I hope. In honor-based cultures, civil society is weak. Civil society is based on certain strong institutions, like the police force, like your clergy. It breaks my heart to see so many churches shut down. The infrastructure of the coal towns has collapsed, right? But what happens when you can't trust your police department? Now, I've talked to Blair Hibbs, June Hibbs. Anybody here from Glace Bay? Yeah. Don't say anything, but who knows? Just raise your hand. Who knows who buried June Hibbs? If you were born before Trudeau-mania, we're not talking about Justin Trudeau, but Pierre Trudeau, you will know what happened to June Hibbs. It's interesting because my mom and dad used to stand around with Ann and David, and they would talk about the Glace Bay police pilfering Thompson and Sutherland's, taking whatever they wanted from Schwartz's, little raids at the Canadian Tire. Again, I don't know how much of this is true, because I was only about 10 or 11 when this happened. But I do know that my mom and Ann, women tended to gossip by themselves and not often with their husbands, right? But this was serious. And the way they talked about this, that this was a serious matter, what happened. And that they talked in a low voice, and that although I couldn't understand what they were talking about, that what happened to June Hibbs was bad, and bad things were happening, right?
Who buried her?
What's that?
I now want to know how was she buried, or who buried her?
I don't want to have a lawsuit, but...
Because I often wondered.
Well, that's the thing about a Gothic... I mean, I call my thing Cape Breton Gothic. In these... I call industrial Cape Breton the sweet spot for paranoia. Because the towns are small enough that you can just about know everybody, but they're large enough that you can kind of disappear under the radar, right?
That's the answer?
For a nominal fee, you can have a definitive answer. And so, I mean, there are a lot of theories, but I can't say that's painful, is that, you know, I talked to Blair, and he's very successful. He's also got a lot of pain, even now. And, you know, I talk to him sometimes, and he can't talk about this for very long without getting upset. And so let's move along from that. And, of course, we don't even have to talk about what happened to Donald Marshall in 71 and the police force of John McIntyre. And then lastly, I'd like to talk about the Clayton Miller case, which is a cause célèbre, right? My definitive stance on what happened to Clayton Miller is that I'm not sure. I remain agnostic about Clayton's ultimate fate. But there are certain things that I will say unequivocally, having read an awful lot of the papers, and dug as deeply as I could, and tried to be as dispassionate a scholar as I could be. Here are things that you can say about the New Waterford Police Department, and I would say this in a court of law. That the scene of Clayton Miller's death was not cordoned off. His body was spirited away after 15 minutes. The coroner was not called. Fiber samples were not taken. Notes of the incident were not taken for months. I can say this too, and I will say this. Sometimes you have to name names. Bernie White, who was the town clerk, and Mayor Marsh were sending letters back and forth to the Nova Scotia Police Commission, which is a direct conflict of interest. they were messing around in the police commission's business. These things I can say from having looked at documents. I'm not saying this as a fan of one side or the other. I think if you're charitable, those are firing offenses, right? That's Bush League policing. There was a lot of nepotism and shoddy police work back in those days. In fact, I think a really good book would be a history of police culture in Cape Breton from, say, the 1970s until they moved out the Mounties. Here's an interesting thing. The famous beer bash riot of 1991. So it's May 25th in New Waterford, and the beer bash is going strong. And at about midnight or 1 o'clock, a fight breaks out. Rather fight than eat. And it's a year after Clayton Miller's death, and people are angry. The police in New Waterford had been brought up on 13 charges of abuse. I've read some files from a fellow who didn't have skin in the game. His name was Ed McNeil. And there's some pretty brutal beatings, and they were basically dismissed. I don't know if all of it was true. I don't know if some of it was true, but it was very chagrining, right? And so what happens is that the night gets longer, and people get drunker, and they drag the police out of the rink. And three policemen end up hiding in a police cruiser while these people are calling them Miller killers, right? So what I'm saying here, beyond these being salacious cases and ready for cold case files or whatever, is that there's a history here of people mistrusting the authorities, right? Some of it's paranoid, and some of it isn't. And in honor-based societies, honor-based cultures, there's a distrust of authority, whether it's Besco and Roy Wolven, or Doug Crow, or John McIntyre. Burning Man. Is anybody here from New Waterford?
Yeah.
You know, I guess you know who's building that is. That's a building on fire. So here's a quote. I thought it was important to write it down. This is from the dissertation. When citizens are at the heels of criminals who break the law with impunity and fearful of the authorities who enforce the law arbitrarily, civil society buckles. You see that in the coal towns. You see that. Glace Bay has its drug lord, or lords, and New Waterford has its. And they tend to be a type. I call them Lester Flat, right? They tend to be in their late 50s, or around 60. They have these modest homes with nice fences. They have a nice truck, maybe a better satellite dish than you, and maybe butterflies on the lawn, but they have their middlemen, and they have their schemes, and they're hard to catch. The middlemen will do jail as just the cost of doing business. Sometimes the big kahunas go off, sometimes they don't. Sometimes they have arson schemes, sometimes they don't. This stuff, you know, I shouldn't get angry about this stuff. I was talking to a cop who was trying to catch New Waterford's Lester Flat. I said, why can't you catch this guy? I mean, I've just taken 4 shuttle bus rides and I know everything about this guy. And you know what he said to me? He said he's a real bastard, and he's very good at what he does. And if I could catch him, I would. So if you have, but let's think about it. I always thought Glace Bay was the craziest place I ever met. I'm thinking New Waterford runs a close second.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Yeah. And,
it's first now.
Well, but when I was walking down Plumber Avenue, I was thinking, this place is infested with drug dealers who can't be caught. Everybody knows who they are. And then people don't really trust the police. Right? Some people wish the Millers would go away. Some people valorize the Millers. Right? People, there's an air of suspicion. You don't talk about that stuff, right? Keep it to yourself, right? And that's the kind of stuff that makes it difficult to grow this place, to improve this place. One of the things, I think, anyway. So here we are, near the end. As William Faulkner said, the past is never dead. It's not even past. Now, we saw that with the Gala College turning down the royal decree. 250 years. But then again, you see generation after generation of traumatized coal miners drinking and fighting. That doesn't seem to end either, right? I'm going to play a tune and then we'll look at this last quote. I think you all know this tune.
I'm a barbarian. I'm a Cape Breton barbarian. Well, we all are. Or didn't you know? Yes, I'm a hairy and scary one. That's how the mainland saints go. I'll drink it and waiting is all that I do, and I don't belong to a club or clique. And I'll lift no finger to work each day, except to paint my nose in public. I'm a Cape Breton barbarian. Well, we all are, or didn't you know? Yes, I'm a hairy and scary one. That's how the mainland saints go. Our the mounted police, so they give me no peace whenever I get in the law's way. Cause I'm down from the hill and I'm ready to kill anyone crossing the causeway. I'm a Cape Breton barbarian. Well, we all are, or didn't you know? Yes, I'm a hairy and scary one. That's how the mainland saints go. Ah, but how much tax goes to Halifax? And how much of it comes back? And how much steel and how much coal left on the westbound train track? Call a man a barbarian, tell him he needs to have culture, then make him your own beast of burden and claim the spoils of the vulture. Oh, give me a place of quiet shame, give me a soulful song to sing. Allow me the friendship I hold so dear. Oh, give me the peaceful and silent flame. Well, I'm a Cape Breton barbarian. Well, we all are, or didn't you know? Yes, I'm a hairy and scary one. That's how the mainland saints go.
How much tax goes to Halifax? And how much of it comes back? That's 1977, right? What always boggled my mind was that phrase was no longer operative in 1977. I was having lunch with Elaine, and Elaine is really cosmopolitan. She's well put together, and she's well healed, and she makes her Costco runs, and she has friends who play golf on the Grand Lake Highway road there. And she said to me, you know, Halifax was built on the backs of Cape Breton coal miners. And I'm thinking, Elaine, that was true maybe in 1920 or 1925. But, you know, coal was taken over by the state in 1967, as was steel. Cape Breton hasn't subsidized anything for over 50 years. Now, these past injustices are true and real, but at what point do they become like ghosts that haunt you and just won't go away? Can you give them up, right? John Morgan fought the good fight in this lawsuit, but it was a fool's errand. You know, it's probably true and ethically true that Cape Breton, CBRM, was screwed by the provinces. But from a legal standpoint, it doesn't pass muster, and yet he fought and fought and fought. How many wasted years? I mean, I look at John Morgan as the last iteration of J.B. McLaughlin. The coal miners had to fight. There was no other way. You were going to starve. They did starve. But at what point, after 50 years of having a benevolent state subsidizing things, does this just become a waste of time people spend in their gears? So I'll end with this. Would you rather J.B. McLaughlin 2.0 or Alan J. Redux? Right? Right now we have Jeff McClellan and Roger Cusner. Justin Trudeau has turned on the spigot, and now money's coming to Cape Breton. Again. But the problem, when capital comes from elsewhere, when the lords come from elsewhere, that money comes and that money goes. And you're dependent on external forces for your survival. Right? You're always going to have to fight, and you're never sure how you're going to eat. You want something new. I don't know what the something new is, but we've tried a lot of things and I'm not sure they work. right? Do you have to fight or eat? Is it a binary question? I don't know the answer. I want to end on an upbeat note because there are lots of fantastic things in Cape Breton. There's Ashley, was it Ashley who made Werewolf, Ashley McKenzie? Right. You have Dave Soller at Undercurrent, ministering to all those youth in Clayce Bay and now in Sydney. You have these great Dr. Luke's, a respectable coffee house. I love Dr. Luke's. And you have my guy, I have a soft spot for, is Jofo. Now I'm 52, so you know, it's like, I've had a good run. And we're all a little gray here, looks like it. We've had our run. So the question is, what do we do for the regular Joes, these kids who want to make it in the world? Right, the young ones, the young creative ones. I don't know. They'll have to figure it out. I can't figure it out. But I will leave you with Jofo, because that's the future.
I'm off and on, but on the line, making it through my day. See, I just won't stop it all, but I won't let them break me. I'm strong enough, I'll survive. Have to live through my own life. People always say that I'ma make it, and it makes me cry. Not what people say to me, that makes me confused. Trying to please everybody but me is giving me the blues. So I'm alone, inside my room, deep inside I'm filled with gloom. What do I do? Where do I go? Only man out here care about Joe, go listening to him now. I ain't living in a place like Brown, just a younger man trying to do monkey bars like back in school. No one's seen a lot, but I hang out when I'm stopping by. Around the house or in the street or at the bar, I'm
just a regular Joe, regular job.
Those guys going out there, the social stress on families is incredible.
Right.
I don't have the answers on that, right? I know it's hard on the families. They, you know, some young guys go out there and they make a lot of money and buy trucks. But the economy, the oil economy is in the dumpster now, I guess, somewhat. So again, it's that boom and bust cycle. And the difficulty is to come up with an organic Cape Breton economy.
Right.
So we're not relying on